I'll be reading from the Revised Standard Version this morning. The first scripture reading is Isaiah 35, verses 1 through 10. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are fearful, hark, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, and with recompense of God he will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing for joy. For waters shall break forth the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and a thirsty ground springs of water. The haunt of jackals shall become a swamp. The grass shall become reeds and rushes. And a highway shall be there, and it shall be called the Holy Way. The unclean shall not pass over it, and fools shall not err therein. No lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast come up on it. They shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransom of the Lord shall return, and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. The New Testament lesson is that familiar chapter from Luke, but we'll be starting at verse 46 instead of 47 and reading through to 55. And Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has regarded the low estate of his handmaid. For behold, henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. For his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has put down the mighty from their thrones, and exalted those of low degree. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent empty away. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his posterity forever. Thus ends the readings.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. As the choir has sang, we are in this period of Advent, a time of waiting, waiting for the coming of Emmanuel, God with us. As the choir sang, we are in this season of Advent with longing, longing for the coming of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. And as we do in our culture, of course, it is a time of preparation, a time to get those Christmas cards put together and mailed out, a time to decorate as we are decorated here, a time to go out and do your Christmas shopping, collecting gifts to share with one another as we remember the greatest gift of all, Jesus our Lord. I was out shopping the other day, and yet again I had that opportunity to go into the marketplace and watch the crush of people, to watch the supposed Christmas spirit at work, which is not always very gentle, meek, and mild, not very Christmas-like at all. And if that wasn't enough, I had yet again that rich opportunity to hear the songs of Christmas. You know the ones, Silver Bells, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Santa Claus, or one that particularly caught my ear as I was in a not-to-be-named store. It went like this. Something about Santa running over Grandma with his reindeer. Well, you know, after several hours of this exposure to our wonderful culture, I started to feel a little bit jaded. Little callous, a little shock-worn, in fact. And then I happened to go to Barnes & Noble, which is not surprising if you know me. And as I was meandering, looking at a variety of texts and wonderful Christmas items, I noticed in the front of the store there were these 12 or 13 little children. They gathered themselves and they started to sing the wonderful Christian carols of Christmas. In their delicate and gentle voices, they were singing, they were redeeming, they were trying so hard to get it all right. And that jadedness just melted away. And I thought to myself, I asked myself, what is my Advent song? What is my Advent anthem, just to be poetic? What song do we sing as we wait and long for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ? And then looking at the text today, I heard that Magnificat, that magnificent song that the Virgin Mary sang during that first Advent season, that time in which she was impregnated and waiting, trying to figure out the complex mystery of it all. The song that she sang in the Visitation when she went to see Elizabeth, who was expecting John the Baptist, and that infant in her womb left to be in the presence of his Lord, the embryonic Jesus Christ. Wow, what a song. What a song Mary sings. Her song in this Advent season, this Advent anthem begins to us, given to us in praise. She says, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed. It is a song of praise, recognizing her individual condition to be so chosen from all of the women of time, from all of the people alive at that time, to be chosen to be the mother of Jesus. In a society which would oppress her for her condition, in a society in which she would be condemned as a sinner, in a society that would not hear her voice about the miracle, she does not respond with fear. She responds with faith. She responds with praise. Advent is a time for us to recapture yet again the wonder, the mystery, and the miracle. Advent is a time for us to claim the miracle that Christ himself has come in our hearts and rescued us, each and individually, one. It's a time to say, Lord, you've touched me. You've given me faith in you. And certainly I am most lowly. But you have chosen me and you have blessed me. And I praise you. Second, Mary's song is a song about fulfillment. It is masterfully written. It was used in the early church, especially the Jewish Christian church in Jerusalem, as a core text of their worship service. It declares and intertwines the assertions with a rich history of biblical prophecy in the Old Testament. It declares sevenfold what God is doing in that Advent time, what God is doing as Mary carries the Christ child. It says, in a series of seven, he has formations. He has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. It says that he has shown strength with his arms. He has scattered the proud and the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy. It says, the Mighty One has done great things for me. The Mighty One has done great things for us. This form of articulation tells us in quintessence what the agenda of the coming of the Redeemer means. It is as though God has this computer and pushes the reset button, restoring it to its original factory design. In Jesus Christ, the sin of the world is conquered. In Jesus Christ, the lowly are lifted up, the proud and haughty are broken down. There is a new peace. There is a new hope. There is new joy. There is a restoration in this wonderful Jesus Christ who is yet to come. In Jesus Christ, the perfect will of God is fulfilled. And third, this song, this Advent anthem, is a time for us to yet again claim the promise. The promise is this: he has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy. Why? According to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and his descendants forever. God keeps his promises. The promises that he gave to Abraham and Sarah and all the generations of God's people. All the generations of Christendom, all these promises can be relied on. The promise of the forgiveness of sins, the promise of God's redeeming grace, the promise of God's steadfast mercy and love, the promise, ultimately, of eternal life, living with our risen and victorious Lord. What a wonderful song to sing during Advent. Our Advent anthem is a declaration of our individual faith as it begins in Mary's. It is a declaration of the universal faith that's offered to all people in Jesus Christ. It is a song about praising God. It is a song about God's fulfillment of his promises. It is a song about the eternal promise. And that, my friends, is the true song, the Advent anthem, that I hope and pray that you're singing in your hearts today. One final theological observation. Mary sang this song when she was pregnant. Mary sang this song when Jesus was yet to be born, yet to live, yet to teach,
yet to redeem on Calvary's Hill. In fact, the song that Mary sings is written in the aorist tense. It's written in a past tense, as though all these things had already come. Wow! She captures the quintessence of the gospel. She declares the same. She articulates that her faith and hope in her impregnation has already created the new reality of a new heaven and a new earth and a new kingdom of God. And so she marches on. She marches on equipped with solid faith all the way to Bethlehem where her child Jesus is born. May we too live with such confidence in God that we consider the promises of God already accomplished. May we consider the blessings and promises of God for eternal life already real for us. May we appropriate God's grace and mercy with a steadfast confidence that God has already said, "Welcome, my child, my precious one." May we live in the present and in the future, regarding God's promises as a confident past in our persons. Yes, let us sing our Advent anthems, songs of praise and songs of fulfillment and songs of promise. Amen.
Let us confess. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and stood on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe.
so freely let yourselves give. To further God's kingdom, we must do our due diligence. So give out of the heart of joy today.
Lord God, lift us up.
and give us your peace. Bless our nation with peace. O Lord God, give this world your world peace. Now bless us, we pray, as we take to our lips the prayer that the dear Lord taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive thy debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I will have a chat with that administrative assistant of mine. She put us in the wrong pew today with that trespass versus death thing. But why not? Our final hymn is number 129, Lo, How a Rose Hair Blooming. Amen.